Dear students, in the past lectures I've explained you how to calculate the performance of a specific aircraft at the various phases of a mission. This mission consists of climb, horizontal flight, the cruise, and descent. In this mission I treated minimum airspeed, maximum airspeed, range, endurance, maximum rate of climb, maximum climb angle, minimum rate of descent, and finally the minimum glide angle. For these calculations there is one very useful tool, the performance diagram, in which maximum power available and power required can be plotted. Now this performance diagram is a typical example of a propeller aircraft. You could just as well plot thrust and drag. Now based on the position of these two curves, the airspeeds for maximum performance can be easily determined. So, it seems like that we covered all there is to do. However, there's one thing we should not forget. When drawing this diagram, or making the calculations, I always assume to be flying at a specific altitude. However, the performance of an aircraft depends on the atmospheric conditions as well. Now, there is probably a reason why all commercial aircraft are cruising at approximately 10 kilometers altitude instead of 5 kilometers altitude. So, the aim of today's lecture is to determine the effect of altitude on aircraft performance. If we're able to calculate the performance limits of an aircraft, minimum airspeed, maximum airspeed, and maximum altitude, we can actually determine all combinations of altitude and airspeed at which an aircraft can operate. So, how do we create this diagram? Remember that the performance diagram was the key to all performance calculations. I'm now going to investigate how the performance diagram changes as a function of altitude. Now let's start with the specific performance diagram for sea level conditions. If the engine is able to provide enough thrust, then the pilot can choose any airspeed on the curve to fly at. Now, you know that in order to fly slowly, you need to increase the angle of attack in order to create enough lift. At high airspeeds, on the other hand, the dynamic pressure will help to create lift, and thus the airplane can fly at a small angle of attack. So, each point on the diagram actually relates to a specific angle of attack and thus a specific CL and CD. Now let us keep the angle of attack constant and thereby also the CL and the CD. And next let's determine what happens to a specific point on the diagram when we start increasing altitude. So let's draw this performance diagram once again with forces on the y-axis and airspeed on the x-axis, and let's draw the drag curve. Now I just indicated that we're interested to see what happens to a single point on the curve. And if you would do that for all points on the curve, you could actually determine what happens to the complete curve when we increase altitude. So like I said before, we're going to keep angle of attack constant, and thereby we also keep CL and CD constant, because they are directly determined by the angle of attack. So, since we have a diagram with drag, with a drag curve, we should actually write out what drag is. So, if we take drag, we can also write it as being drag multiplied with lift divided by lift. And since we already know that lift is equal to weight in this condition, we could also say that this equals drag divided by lift multiplied with the aircraft weight, and this we can rewrite into CD over CL times the weight. Now this is an important observation because CD and CL are given to be constants. And if we also consider one moment in time in which the aircraft weight is also more or less constant, you can say that this drag is not a function of the air density. So if I would write the drag at one altitude, it equals CD over CL times the weight, and that will thereby also be equal to the drag at any other altitude, since there is no air density dependency. So now we have looked at one side of the curve, the y-axis, but let's also look at the other side of the curve, the x-axis, because both x and y determine in which direction the point is going to move, if it is going to move. Now, based on lift is equal to weight, we already know that airspeed is equal to weight over s, 2 over rho, and 1 over cl. Now, again, lift coefficient remains constant. We also work with a constant aircraft weight, and of course the wing surface area of the aircraft is not going to change. However, this air density here in the equation will change whenever we change altitude. So the airspeed at altitude 1 would be equal to weight over s, 2 over air density at altitude 1 times 1 over cl, and there the square root of, and the weight or the airspeed at altitude 2 would be equal to the square root of the same function, but now with a variation that we have air density at altitude 2. So what this essentially means is that the airspeed at this second air density, if we assume that point 2 is at a lower altitude, or at a higher altitude, I should say, than point 1, therefore being air density smaller than the air density at altitude 1, we will find that the airspeed at air density 2 will be larger than the airspeed at air density 1. And this is an important observation. Basically, if we keep angle of attack constant, and thereby CL and CD, if we go to a higher altitude, in fact, air density decreases, and in order to keep the amount of lift enough to balance the weight, we must increase the airspeed so that we have more dynamic pressure and thereby a bit more lift. So, in terms of the diagram, this means that if we increase altitude, actually this point here is going to move in a horizontal fashion to the right. Now, we could actually do this for all points on the curve, and you will find the same result, of course. And if you would do that, you would find that by increasing altitude, this whole curve is going to shift to the right-hand side. Now, that is basically the effect of altitude on the performance diagram. But as you know, we always also draw a performance diagram in terms of power versus speed. And this diagram looks fairly similar to the drag curve. It's just rotated slightly, because in order to go from drag to power, you have to multiply with airspeed. So for this curve, we could do the same thing, and we could try to figure out what happens to this specific point on the curve. Now, we already know what is going to happen to airspeed. Airspeed is going to increase when we increase altitude, but what happens to power? Now, power is by definition drag multiplied with speed. So the power at altitude 1 will be equal to the drag at altitude 1 multiplied with the speed at altitude 1, and the power at altitude 2 will be equal to the drag at altitude 2 multiplied with the speed at altitude 2. Now, if you would rewrite this slightly, then you would find that the power at altitude 1 divided by the speed at altitude 1 equals the drag at altitude 1. So I've just rewritten this equation a bit. I basically put drag on the right-hand side of the equation and power and speed on the left-hand side. But since we already know that the drag at altitude 1 and the drag at altitude 2 are equal, we could say, well, this is equal to the drag at altitude 2. So therefore, this is power at altitude 2 divided by the speed at altitude 2. So if we take this, we could actually say that the ratio of power divided by speed remains constant whenever we increase altitude. So what does that mean in our diagram? Well, basically, for this specific point, actually the x-axis is a measure for speed and the y-axis position is a measure for power. So if I was to draw a line from the origin to this point, then the angle here is an indication of power divided by the speed. So that means if this remains constant, then the angle with respect to the origin also remains constant, and the point here is going to move in this direction whenever we increase the altitude. And I could do that for all points on the diagram. So what you will observe is that if we plot the same diagram for another altitude, it will look something like this. And this shows us that the drag curve is going to shift to the right-hand side with increasing altitude, and the power curve is going to shift upwards and to the right-hand side when increasing altitude. So, summarizing, we just determined that the drag curve shifts to the right with increasing altitude and the power required curve shifts upwards and to the right. Now, this is only one side of the performance diagram. In order to calculate the performance, we also need to know what happens to the propulsion of the aircraft, thrust and power. Will engine thrust actually change with increasing altitude? Yes, it will definitely. At higher altitudes, the air density decreases and the temperature decreases as well, up to 11 kilometers. Now, beyond 11 kilometers, the temperature remains more or less constant and the air density keeps on going down. Now, remember that the general equation for thrust, which states thrust is mass flow times the velocity difference that we give to the air, shows us that thrust depends on mass flow and airspeed. Now, a higher altitude means that air density actually decreases and therefore the mass flow decreases as well. So if we keep all other factors constant, this would mean that the thrust level would go down. On the other hand, colder air also means that more energy can be put into the air inside the engine, since the operation of the combustion chamber is limited by the maximum temperature of the material. So, in general terms, the mass flow effect is always dominant, and thrust and thereby power available will reduce with increasing altitude. So, in cold conditions at low altitude, aircraft can generate a lot of thrust, whereas maximum thrust is very low in hot and high condition. So this greatly influences performance, and as example I can show you the takeoff distance required for an actual small business jet in both conditions for an average aircraft weight. Takeoff distance depends to a great extent on maximum thrust, and in cold and low conditions the distance is about 2,000 meters for this aircraft, and in hot and high conditions it's actually 6,000 meters. So this is a difference of a factor 3, quite an important difference. Now, unfortunately, by how much is the thrust and power reduces is very much dependent on the specific engine we're working with. So the engine manufacturer will typically provide such information. Usually the reduction in thrust or power can be represented with the following equations. The factor N in these equations will vary for each specific type of engines. In a generic performance diagram, the effect of altitude will look as follows. You can immediately see from this diagram that aircraft performance, such as maximum speed, minimum speed, and maximum rate of climb, determined by the distance between the two graphs, is very much affected by altitude effects. So, summarizing, we have just derived how the performance diagram changes with increasing altitude. And next time, I will use this information to determine aircraft performance as a function of altitude.